Bible. You got your Bibles with you this morning? How many of you know this song? The B-I-B-L-E. It's look for me. I stand long on the word of God. The B-I-B-L-E. Now those of you that weren't raised with this song in church, you're looking at us like we are crazy. While they bring my table up here, somebody bring my table up here while they bring it up. Let's try it one more time. Everybody, it's really simple. You spell the Bible. Yes, that's the book for me. The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the word of God. The B-I-B-L-E. Oh, there it is, the Bible cheer. I love it. You guys listen to Sunday school class, and if you've never heard that song before, you're like, man, I just came to church. Why do you make me sing these crazy songs? Well, now you've got something new to go home and share with your friends. I'm sure you'll be dying to share that with them, won't you? What about this one? Try one more with you. Hold your Bibles up if you got them. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide his words in my heart that I might not sin against God. Man, you guys are doing good. You guys are doing good. You guys are doing good with your pledges. You're doing good with your songs this morning. I'm doing good clearing out mistakes for myself. Y'all can give me a cookie later for that. This morning, I want to talk to you about my journey with the Bible. Because my journey with the Bible was one that started when I was learning those songs, okay? My first experience is learning those songs, learning those little sayings. There are two things growing up that I was raised never to doubt. Never to doubt these two important truths. Number one, the Pittsburgh Steelers are the greatest football team that has ever played the game. That is undeniably true. I have the rings to prove it. I don't have the rings to prove it, but number two, the Bible is the Word of God. Now, I don't put those in order of priority. Of course, I believe more that the Bible is the Word of God than everything about the Steelers. But growing up, I can remember sitting in Sunday school class. I was 6 years old, and I had a light bulb go off in my head for the very first time. Now, maybe you learned this a lot earlier, but for the very first time, the light bulb went off in my head about the division between the Old and the New Testament. You know, that Moses lived before Jesus. A lot of our Bible stories that we teach kids sometimes can get a little disjointed and disconnected. So we'll have Noah this week, right? And then the next week we'll have Jesus healing the blind man. So as far as I knew, Noah and Jesus were just two guys that hung out together, you know, back in Bible days. I learned at 6 years old there was a light bulb that went off in my head. All the Old Testament stuff happened prior to the first coming of Jesus. And believe it or not, when I was seven years old, I had a family. One side of the family was Pentecostal, the other side was Baptist. So those two got together. That was fun, okay? And I began to be obsessively interested in the varying denominations and their different interpretations of the Bible. I really became interested in that. I wanted to know all that I could about that. And you don't have to say anything, because Pastor Wes has already explained to me this week just how weird I was back then as a kid for wanting to know about those things. I can remember being 8 years old and sitting in my third grade classroom and hearing the science teacher talk about various topics, and it would cause my little mind to ask questions about the interplay between faith and science. And I wanted to know how the Bible factored into that and how we interpret the Bible in light of our natural world and science. And then my 10 years old, giving you a timeline here today, my 10 years old, I was reciting this whole eschatological framework to my friends. I'm talking about an end times framework to my friends. Now, one that I don't particularly hold to today, because I don't believe today a lot of things I believed when I was 10 years old, okay? But I could recite it out for them perfectly. But you know, these were just facts that I understood about the Bible that I had been raised to believe and to conceptualize. But when I was 15 years old, I had my first broken heart. There you go. That's what I was looking for. I was looking for a little compassion. I had my first real broken heart when I was 15 years old. And I remember feeling all alone and isolated, like Nobody wanted me. I wasn't good enough for anybody. And I felt really down on myself. You know, teenage drama, drama, drama stuff. But you know what? God cares about our teenage drama because He loves us. And I picked up the Bible, my old King James Version Bible that my grandfather had given me. Had all his notes scribbled in it, all over it. And I turned to Psalm 39 and I began to read. And when I got to verse 7, it was like the Lord was speaking it as a direct revelation to me when He says, the psalmist writes, "And now, Lord, what wait I for? My hope is in Thee." Tears began to well up in my eyes and started to soak the pages of that Bible. Clarity was brought to my situation immediately. I began to understand, number one, that God cares about me. He loves me and He speaks to me through His Word. And the second thing that I began to realize was that I didn't need anybody else. My hope and my contentment and my fulfillment were not going to be found in a member of the opposite sex, but it was going to be found in Jesus. And my thinking began to be clarified and reoriented back to Christ just through the words of what God was speaking to me in that moment. And it was at that time, I believe, for the first time really for me, that I found the words of the writer in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12 to be true. For the Word of God is living and active. It is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. I realized at that moment, the Word of God can pierce through whatever mess I've had in my life and get straight to the heart of the matter. Today I want us to get more in love with His Word as we're in this Reaching Higher series. I've found on a regular basis that this phenomenon can be true for us. In many ways, the story of my life has been defined by my journey with the Bible. And everybody's journey is not going to be the same as my journey. I decided that I was going to go on and dedicate the rest of my life to studying it. And that I was going to go to college and to seminary and study the Bible in its original languages and its context. Everybody's journey is not going to be the same as mine. Maybe for some of you, your journey with the Bible is just starting. But wherever you are in your journey with Scripture, know this, that welcome, we want to help you reach higher commitments with regard to your devotion to Scripture because we believe that it is crucial to our mission here, our devotion to the Bible. Maybe you're here and you say, well, I've just started my journey with Christ. Or maybe you had one of those little ones that got baptized last week and you say, well, they're just starting in their journey with Christ. Well, let me just tell you this as well. You may be struggling to understand what the will of God is for you in your life, and you may be trying to discern what path He wants you to go down. Can I tell you that today, if you listen intently to my pleas for you to devote yourself to Scripture, things are going to start becoming clearer in your life as you try to start this discipleship journey with Jesus. Has anybody in here found that to be true today? Amen. I want to give you three things this morning to encourage you to reach higher with us in our devotion to Scripture. Number one, first thing, read it to find Christ. Read it to find Christ. One of the main reasons we stand on the authority of the Bible here at Welcome Church is because the Bible is the primary witness that points us to Jesus. The Bible directs our thoughts and our attention to Jesus. And it's very important to point out that the Bible is not the object of our worship. It points us to the object of our worship. It's not Father, Son, and Holy Bible, right? What's the Trinity? Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And the interesting thing is the Pharisees were having this very same issue. John 5, verses 39 through 40. Jesus is talking to the Pharisees, and you'll see his words on the screen. When he says to them, "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. And it is they that bear witness about me. Yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life." What was the mistake of the Pharisees? You see, their difficulty was that they believed that Scripture was an end in itself. That if they would just learn the contents of Scripture, that if they would just make themselves students of it, follow its rules to the best of their ability and keep their teaching, that somehow they were going to find eternal life in those Scriptures. What does Jesus say? No. You missed the point in making the Scriptures the object of your love and devotion. I am the one to whom the Scriptures point. Yet what did they do? Tragically, they refused to come to the one that the Scriptures pointed to. So when I engage the Scriptures today, I engage them in a way of understanding that the whole record, all of the Bible, is pointing me to Jesus. I want to encourage you towards more devotion to Scripture today in your own personal reading, really for one main purpose, so that you will fall more in love with the one they're about. I want to see you fall more in love with Jesus. And if you want to know His heart, if you want to commune with Him more, if you want to feel His presence more in your life, get in His book. Amen? Now all this brings us to one very practical point. When you read the Bible, I want to encourage you to read it as one overarching narrative that finds both its climax and its resolution in Jesus Christ. You see, the Old Testament points us to Jesus. The Old Testament ends, but it really doesn't end, does it? When we come to the end of the Old Testament, it leaves us begging for a conclusion. Israel's problems have not met their resolution yet when the Old Testament comes to a close. Israel has not had their great deliverer and Messiah yet when the Old Testament comes to a close. And when we pick up the New Testament and begin to work through the pages of the New Testament, we find that Jesus is not a new story. He's the continuing story of God and His people. And as that story continues, we begin to see it come to its resolution as their God, their Messiah, their suffering servant is crucified for their deliverance. The story of Scripture is a story about Jesus, I assure you. According to Rowan Williams, he was the former Archbishop of Canterbury with the Church of England. I love how he puts it. This story essentially goes something like this. If you want to look at it as one narrative, it's a story about God loving what He has made, being faithful to what He has made, and coming to dwell with what He has made in the person of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. Sure, it's 66 books. I get that. I understand. But it's more than 66 books. They are connected together, pointing to Jesus. And on this point, my last bit of encouragement for you. When you find yourself getting bogged down and stuck, so to speak, in certain passages. And it's easy to get stuck in certain passages. Am I right? When you find yourself getting stuck in certain passages of Scripture, I want you to think about this. How is this Scripture pointing me to Jesus? Press through, continue to read it, and ask yourself, how is this Scripture pointing me to Jesus? If it's the scrupulous law code that you might be reading in parts of Exodus and Leviticus, then I can tell you one way it points you to Jesus according to Galatians. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Romans chapter 8, for what the law could not do, and that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, so that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. That's pretty good, amen? That's how the law points me to Jesus. There's some parts that aren't as obvious of how it points to Jesus. So in those times, I want you to ask yourself this question. How does what I know about Jesus clarify the scripture for me? How do the things that I know to be true about Jesus clarify this scripture for me? And if you don't think that there are scriptures, especially the Old Testament, that sometimes look to be counter what you know about Jesus, then just look at Psalm 137. Well, the Israelite people were pretty ticked off at the Babylonians, and so the psalmist, who's really mad at the Babylonians, writes, "Blessed is the man who dashes your little ones' heads against the stones." Got any Christians that just like, that's my life verse? That's my life verse. Love it. But if you don't read the Psalms in light of what you know about Jesus, those imprecatory Psalms, we call them, where they're crying out for vengeance, might not make as much sense to you. Read the Scriptures in light of the grace and the mercy and the love and the inclusiveness and the gathering of Christ. That will help you with the difficult passages. Read it to find Christ. Second point. Read the Bible as food from Christ. Read the Bible as food from Christ. Now, on this point, my wife, who's in the nursery, our newly positioned nursery here, has come to save the day for all of you, okay? Because you may be thinking to yourself, you know, Pastor Josh, that's really great, reading the Bible in light of Jesus, asking questions in light of Jesus. I get that. I understand it. It's really hard when I find myself in the middle of a genealogy. And this one begat that one, and that one begat that one, and that one begat that one. And there was all sorts of words I used to look at in the King James Bible back in the day that I didn't understand, like that one, like begat. Mature concepts. Found the Bible sometimes. Like Abraham knew his wife. Whatever that. Of course he knew his wife. What's that supposed to mean? Mom, Dad, why is it? They just met? No, anyway. When you find yourself in the thick of it, of a genealogy or something that is a little more of a boring part where it's telling you each person who built each and every part of the tabernacle. I want you to think of it this way. When my wife came to me and she says, Pastor Josh, no, she doesn't call me Pastor Josh. She came to me and she said, dummy, no, she doesn't call me dummy. She said, honey, I sometimes struggle to make the Bible readable. Sometimes there are portions that seem unreadable. And I want to be passionate about reading the Bible because I know that's what we're called to do as Christians, but sometimes it's unreadable. And I said, honey, I sympathize with you. And I want you to know, if you feel that way out there, I sympathize with you. And my wife sympathizes with you. But I want to encourage you like I encouraged her. As you're reading it, read it as spiritual vitamins. And how many of you know that sometimes vitamins and food that has a lot of vitamins in it doesn't always taste good? That's why we continue to cook the vegetables until all the vitamins are out of them. Because I don't like eating crunchy vegetables, I like eating soft, chewy vegetables, okay? We cook them until they're out of them because we don't particularly like the taste of vitamins. And vitamins are not always pleasant. And it's not always obvious how vitamins are going to pay off for us. But we know they're going to. And our bodies will tell us that they're paying off by the signals it's sending us. The same thing is true for your spiritual life and the Word of God. Yes, the genealogies. Yes, the scrupulous details about building projects and so on and so forth are the Word of God, and they have spiritual vitamins in them. You continue to read them as food from Christ, even if they're not always pleasant and easy to read. Now, here's what the Bible says about itself when it comes to its spiritual nourishment. In Hebrews chapter 5, verses 12 through 14. Hebrews chapter 5, verses 12 through 14. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You can read there. By now, which means you had plenty of time, you ought to be teaching the Bible, but you're having to have people explain to you even the most basic things out of the Word of God. The next phrase to follow up, you need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. But solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice. Practice and what? What's the subject? What's the topic here? The word of God. By constant practice to distinguish good from evil. Friends, you are starving your spiritual life by neglecting to read the Bible. You are going to be spiritually emaciated if you do not read the Bible. We have an opportunity to disciple new believers in this church, and you can't do it if you're not a student of the Bible. You just can't. Now, I've got a few words of encouragement for you. More than a few. I would also suggest to you that not just looking at the Bible as spiritual vitamins, but you also have to understand that the Bible in and of itself, I'm going to use this word sacramental. The Bible is sacramental in and of itself. You're probably hearing the word sacraments in there. And as we come to the table like we did last week, and we receive from the Lord's table, He promises us to inhabit that table and meet us there by His grace. And when we consume those elements, it's not merely that we're consuming physical food. We know that, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, it is fellowship, or it is communion spiritually with Christ. We are receiving grace. Now, here's what I want you to know. When you come to the Bible, you are receiving grace as you read it. 1 Thessalonians 2 and verse 13 says this, "And we also thank God constantly for this, that when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as the word of men, but as what it really is, the word of God, which is at work in you believers." Notice that last phrase. The word of God at work in you believers. That means as you get the word of God into you, the word of God begins to work in you. As it goes into you, the word of God can begin to flow out in your daily life, and God has something to work with. Don't you want to give God something to work with in your life? Get into the Bible. It is amazing the things He can do with you when you get the Bible into your spirit. Now, does it say that you're going to feel some superhuman burst of energy after you read the Bible? Does it say that you're going to be entertained as you read the Bible? It simply says that the Bible is going to work effectually in and through you as you consume it. And I want to give you a very practical point of encouragement today if you're struggling with where to start and where to begin. You know, one of the best things you can do so that you don't get as bogged down, this is a practical point, is spread your reading out. Okay? Leviticus can get tiresome. Look at you pious people. Oh, it cannot get tiresome. Do not say that about the Word of God. Leviticus can get tiresome. But you need to read it. And as you're reading it, here's what I encourage you to do. Read a psalm. Read from the Gospels. Read from Paul's letters. spread your reading out, give some variety to your reading, and you might begin to learn more of how they're all interconnected. Now, here's one special way that I want to help you guys do that. We came up with a practical solution for you this morning. We didn't want to make suggestions and not give you something that you can do right now. So if you want to, you can actually feel free to get on your phone right at this moment. You can go to our Facebook page. On Facebook at Welcome Wesleyan, you can like the page if you haven't liked it yet. Or you can go to our newly redesigned, thank God, website, welcomewesleyan.com. Some of you that are on the inside here are laughing a little bit about that one. Thank God it's redesigned. And you can go to welcomewesleyan.com, and right under our menu is a link to this Bible reading program called How to Read the Bible Through for Shirkers and Slackers. So on our Facebook page, it's on the website. You can get on there and you can find it. And basically what that is it's going to have you reading poetry on Sundays. It's going to have you reading the Pentateuch on Mondays, the Old Testament books of history on Tuesdays. And as you progress through the week, you get into the New Testament. And here's the beautiful thing about it. This is the reason it's for shirkers and slackers. It doesn't start with January 1st. Has anybody ever started with January 1st and then it was January 10th before you looked at your list again? Be honest. This is for shirkers and slackers because it doesn't have the date on there, and all you have to do is check off Monday, and if you miss Tuesday, go on to Wednesday and come back to Tuesday the next week, okay? I want you to check that out. You're going to be blessed by it. Third point. Read the Bible to follow Christ. Read the Bible to follow Christ. I want to tell you right off the bat. I want to apologize to you if anybody ever told you that following Jesus is easy. That was not the truth when that person spoke to you. Following Jesus is not easy. Jesus described the discipleship journey with him as taking up your cross daily and following after him. It's not easy. Now you say, and I agree with you, that the gospel means that I can't earn my way to God. And you can't. You can't earn God's love. You can't. Every bit of that is true. But once you fall in love with Jesus and you commit your life to following him, how many of you know that life doesn't immediately become a cakewalk right then? How many of you know that you have to say no to some things as well as saying yes to some things? And that can be very difficult in your walk with Jesus. Well, if you are trying to do this without consuming the Word of God, you are not equipping yourself with the resources God has given you to follow him. He has given you instruction. He has given you help. He will give you comfort through the Scriptures. It is the best way to prepare for your walk with Jesus. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, Paul explains to Timothy just how blessed Timothy was to have grown up in a household that taught him the sacred writings. And he goes on to tell Timothy just what these writings will do for us if we will be faithful to read them. Notice what he says in 2 Timothy 3, starting in verse 14. But as for you, Timothy, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Listen to verse 16 carefully. All Scripture is breathed out by God. That is a very unique word in the New Testament. Theopneustos. All Scripture is breathed out by God. Breathed out by God is the same word. And profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be competent, equipped for every good work. Did you hear that? For how many good works? Every good work. That means everything that you are going to attempt to do for God, he has given you the tools to equip yourself and to resource yourself in order to do it. And it comes through the very word that he has breathed out and given to us in the written revelation of Scripture. How could we not love it? How can we not devote ourselves to it? If you want to make yourselves a more committed disciple, get into the Word. And please, please, if you are discipling others, a good question to ask yourself sometime, not only is who am I following, but who is following me? If you are discipling others, please teach them to equip themselves with the Word of God. Now, this sort of strength and encouragement drawn from the Bible, friends, I want to encourage you, It's worth the hard work. It's worth the study. And we've got to get into it, and when we do, we've got to grasp its meanings by understanding its history. One of the first things we have to begin to do is make sure that we're understanding its immediate context. Guys, say that word with me. Context. Say it one more time. Context. There's no more important word that you can learn when you're studying the Bible. Because a lot of what happens is we don't read it in its context. Which means that we don't read what's immediately preceding it and what's coming after it, how it fits into the book that it's currently in, and how it fits into the rest of the narrative that God is giving us about Jesus. And I've got to be honest with you. A lot of times when I talk with the average churchgoer or the average Christian, I hear things many times that are in error. And the reason they're in error is because we're not reading the Bible in its context. Now, one of the important things to understand is the Bible had an original audience, the latest of which were in the first century. And many times the Bible assumes that the people to whom it was written understand the culture out of which it was written. Are you following me? Which is really easy in the first century. Not so easy 20 centuries later, is it? The fact of the matter is this. You, my friends, have more resources at your disposal to studying Scripture than we have ever had in the history of the church. That is not an exaggeration, that is a fact. You have more resources at your disposal to teach you how to read and interpret Scripture in light of all of its context. And I also don't want to leave you without a place to start there. I'm going to give you a book right now. Well, actually, I wish I had enough copies to give everybody. I'm going to give you a book suggestion right now. How to Read the Bible for All Its Worth. I'll say it one more time. It's a catchy title. How to Read the Bible for All Its Worth by Gordon Fee and Douglas Stewart. It is very important that you get this book. This book is going to help you understand and how to read the Bible in its context, and it's a great place for you to start. Here's the bottom line, friends. At Welcome, we are all about making more disciples and pointing more people to Jesus. We know that here, don't we? Amen? Here's the main part of the bottom line. There is absolutely no way to become more dedicated in our discipleship or make more disciples without deepening our commitment to study Scripture. There is no way to become better disciples or to make more disciples without deepening our devotion to Scripture. What I hope this breeds today is that you'll pick up the Bible more in your personal time. What I hope this breeds today is that more people will want to get connected in our connection groups and go deeper in the Bible with one another than ever before, so that we have to create more and more groups and train more and more leaders because we can't fit all of you that want to get into it. That's what I pray that happens out of this. And I pray that as a community, we continue to reach higher levels of commitment, reaching higher in worship, so that we can reach higher numbers of people. Amen?
Amen.
Let's start with our devotion to Scripture. Are you with me? Amen. Stand with me this morning.